Jerusalem, the holy city, where Islamic mosques, Christian shrines, and Jewish holy places crowd one another, symbols of man's age-old search for God's revelation. One God, revealed by many prophets. Yet man has turned religion into an excuse for division and hatred, even war. In 1868, there came to the Holy Land, across the sea from Persia, another prophet of God. His name was Baha'u'llah, which means glory of God. On the slopes of Mount Carmel, near Haifa, his followers have established the center for an independent world religion called the Baha'i Faith. Here they have built a shrine, gathered sacred writings in a huge archive, planted gardens, the pilgrims, from all parts of the globe. Is there but one more shrine in a land all too crowded with them? Or is it a symbol of God's message for a new age, as the followers of Baha'u'llah believe? Baha'u'llah taught, all prophets are the messengers of one God. Krishna, Moses, Zoroaster, Buddha, Christ, Muhammad, each in his time chosen by God to speak truth to man in a progressive revelation. Baha'u'llah made the oneness of mankind the central principle of his faith, implying an organic change in the structure of society as we know it. Now can his fast-growing band of followers avoid the temptation to believe that theirs is the one true way to God and no other? All over the world today, members of the Baha'i faith are challenged by this question, for they too have temples, national governing bodies, all the paraphernalia of establishment.
Just how capable she will be for the job, because I don't think we can overestimate the importance of our relationship with the United Nations at all these different levels.
I think she's a very good candidate for this position. The United Nations Committee services the Baha'i community. The observer keeps in touch with the non-Baha'i organizations accredited to the UN.
Yet there is no priesthood or clergy. Laymen conduct Baha'i business at the United Nations. Laymen maintain its schools and meeting places, guided in their activities by the principles established by Baha'u'llah.
There's a number of rust spots that you can see, and by putting a coat on there and brushing it down good, we can get by with one coat of paint. Last year, or this year...
In the United States, a typical Baha'i is one reared in the Christian tradition. Though there are some, like Chester Kahn, whose Navajo ancestors worshipped the spirit of the sacred mountain. In India, he is usually of Hindu or Muslim background, and like all good Baha'is, continues to honor the faith of his fathers. Fouad Katarayi is a Persian whose father helped bring the new faith to Japan. For almost a century, Baha'is from Persia were its chief messengers. Today, its typical messenger, or pioneer, is just as likely to come from the Western Hemisphere. For the past 15 years, Jim Stone has lived on the edge of an Indian reservation in the American West.
Bye.
Baha'is see no inevitable conflict between old ways and new, between rich men and poor, between white men and dark. Yet they live a social doctrine so revolutionary it could change the world. And this is exactly what every sincere Baha'i expects it will do. Unlikely revolutionaries, one might think, these gentle people. Roanne Stone with her worldwide correspondence in Esperanto. Jim with his fix-it shop, where there's a welcome and work for any young man who happens to be passing through Gallup, New Mexico.
How you doing? Scratching it off, good? Okay, what's the telephone?
What sets these people apart is their absolute determination to found a new world order based on plans devised by Baha'u'llah a century ago.
I gotta leave with this ringer, so I'll be back in about an hour.
Okay. I'll answer the phone.
Okay. Into thy holy face, that have detached ourselves from all beside thee in this glorious day. We have gathered in this spiritual assembly, united in our views and thoughts. Our purpose is harmonized to exalt thy word amidst mankind.
The Baha'i faith has its own sacred scriptures, its own laws, its own administrative institutions. Baha'i government begins with the local spiritual assembly, always 9 members, elected locally, who govern its affairs. In Gallup, these 9 are a business consultant, a journalist, a housewife, a student, a teacher, a mechanic, a retired bookkeeper, and the Stones.
Jim brought back a request from the city manager of Kenya.
He's setting up this special, he calls it an advisory committee of various people in the community to advise him on what we feel that the city needs for improvement.
The Baha'i Assembly of Gallup represents less than 100 members, few of them people of wealth or political power, yet their brave goal is to make the Baha'i world concept live here and now in this town.
हे मेरे भगवन मैं साक्षी हूँ कि तूने मेरा इसलिए निर्माण किया कि मैं तेरा ज्ञान प्राप्त करूँ और तेरी पूजा करूँ इस समय मैं साक्षी हूँ मेरी निर्बलता और तेरे बल का मेरी यकिंचन का और तेरे धन का अब्दुल बहा.
In Bhavchini, India, the 9 members of the local spiritual assembly represent about 1,000 Baha'is. The village headman is chairman. Its secretary is first son of the leading Brahmin. The assembly also has members of other castes who, a few years ago, would not have dared sit together in the same room. Thus, peacefully but swiftly, the Baha'i way of life begins to alter relationships that have been frozen in rigid caste lines for more than 1,000 years. Bhavchini is a remote village, typical of dozens in central India, where the Baha'i concept of community is bringing about profound changes. The Baha'i way does not glorify poverty and suffering for their own sake. There is even a place of honor for the man of wealth, if he deals honestly and doesn't allow his position to cut him off from the fellowship of the community. Without defying traditional religious principles, the Baha'i develops a new lifestyle, one in which the absolutes of right and wrong, righteousness and wickedness, are constantly tempered by a spirit of justice and compassion. In most societies, religion tends to slip into a niche cut off from everyday concerns. Baha'is seek to reverse this trend, to find in their faith practical solutions for the business at hand. The son's concern about his education, for example, or a father's concern about his farm that's threatened by the moneylenders. These become items for action by the local spiritual assembly at its next meeting. The Baha'is of Bagchini have worked hard to bring irrigation and electricity to this village. But some castes will not benefit unless ways are found to reduce the charges for poorer families. As a Baha'i, headman Virendra Singh sees this as both a municipal problem and a religious one. As a government teacher in a nearby hamlet that has many Muslim children, assembly member Lal Singh, himself of Hindu origin, struggles to bring the traditionally warring factions together in a single public school. Assembly Secretary Lajaram Sharma is a scholar and poet whose lectures and concerts of traditional music are often heard at universities throughout central India.
लेकिन इसके बाद हमको पहले अपना संस्कृत देखना है ये बाद में देखेंगे कल हमने तुमको संस्कृत में कालिदास जी के बारे में चर्चा की थी आज उनके साहित्य के बारे में चर्चा कर रहे हैं तुम इन्हीं छंद तुमको बोलना है लक्षण हमने तुम्हें बताया है बोलिए मालिनी
सरसिज मन वेद्यम
नहीं ये शिखरिणी छंद है इसको ऐसे नहीं पढ़ा जाता इसके पढ़ने का क्रम ये है यदा लोके सूक्ष्मं ब्रजते सहसा तद विपुलताम बोलने लगो
यदा विखिन्नं भवति कृति संधानमिव तत
इसका क्रम भारत जगं संप्रति हेतु देश्यत
भारत जगं संप्रति हेतु
देश्यत You've got to watch the level on these two because they're distorting a little bit.
Using American modes of getting this across.
Let's try to reproduce it on a piano, for instance. There's enough in here that I can't really produce on the piano. And if you try to write out on a piece of music this piece accurately, which is what you'd want to do because it's a very beautiful piece, how could you really be sure that the people you're writing for could sing it back the way it's written? I think the value is going to be in exposing the entire Baha'i world community to these kinds of very exquisite pieces that come out of some culture like this Indian culture.
Until we have embrace a worldwide concept in terms of music, then we're going to be missing out on some very beautiful music just like this.
One occasion that unites all Baha'is is the feast held at 19-day intervals. In each locality, it serves as both a time for fellowship and spiritual refreshment, and for the most mundane kind of community problem solving. Today's guest is Dr. Farhan Olayan, a renowned physician and pioneer who brings greetings from the Baha'is of Gwalior City.
Dr. Sahab Farhan Olayan hamare beech mein padhari hamare mehman ke roop mein padhari hui hai.
Allah. Priya Baha'i Mitro.
Dear Baha'i friends, I am joyful that you have invited me here to this place. The 19-day feast, which we share, is also being observed in many other places all over the world. From this we learn that all men are one all over the world. Our thoughts, our prayers, the work we have to do, all become one and the same. In India, Baha'is gather in the thousands. In Japan, the word has spread more slowly. For a long time, Mr. Sasaki was the only Baha'i in Sapporo, a city of 500,000 people. Gradually, others have joined. Among them, Miss Hara, who first learned of the faith from an American soldier. The local spiritual assembly has as its pioneer and loving servant, Mr. G.B. Tehrani, a retired businessman from Persia. Mr. Tehrani has endured 10 bone-chilling winters here on Hokkaido, far from his children and his grandchildren.
To tell the truth, I have no time to feel lonely. Every night I have guests, and this is my pleasure. They like to come to Baha'i Center, and they feel here their own house, their own room, and therefore I am not alone.
A photo from a friend who has accepted the faith.
He was a university student in Sapporo for several years. And he was studying about the existence of God.
The daily prayer, known to all Baha'is. I have turned my face unto thee, O my Lord. Illumine it with the light of thy countenance. Protect it then from turning to anyone but thee. On weekends, friends from Tokyo and Osaka often fly up to join Mr. Tehrani. Today's visitors are Mr. Montazi, a Persian merchant who helped bring Mr. Tehrani to Hokkaido, and young Fouad Katarahi, who spends his vacations working at the center. Mr. Tehrani receives a small pension from his former business. Beyond this, he, like most Baha'i pioneers, supports himself. He does so by small trading in imported merchandise.
Oh, Sasaki-san, Allahu Akbar! Genki desu ka?
Hello.
Wait a minute.
Hello, Mr.
Thank you very much for your coming.
How
Thank you
are
very much, Miss Flower.
Konnichiwa. Ogenki desu ka?
Fouad often goes with Mr. Tarani to visit Baha'i friends in the village of Shiroi, where fishermen and woodcarvers still maintain the traditions of their Ainu forebears.
We go together to Shiroi, and we go and see the other people. And these are very pure and simple people, those who are in villages. Yes. Always they invited me to go there, to go there, to go there. When I go there, I did nothing. Only they asked me some prayer, Persian prayer. Only this.
There is a gift from Mr. Marataki for the Baha'is of Osaka, a new volume of poems he has written about the ways of the Ainu. A sincere Baha'i, be he a Persian among Ainu or an American Negro on a Navajo reservation, must find a harmony between his beliefs and his work. Often this means giving up a good job. Ray Collins did this when he left the small loan business in Chicago.
It's kind of a hard thing to do. It's a conflict, you know, and Baha'is are human. They have a wife and a family and a mortgage, and their kids have to go to school too, you see. And if you're in a certain position, you're expected to do certain things, you know, to keep your job or something like that. But it just gets to a point where you just have to make a decision.
Here all the leaves open free. The day has come when all men must live as one. Here all the waves open sea, and the leaves open too, and the flowers open wide. In 1844, in the city of Shiraz, a new and wondrous message was sent forth from God. A young person man writing him of the
In deepening sessions the world over, Baha'is and their friends ponder the writings of Baha'u'llah and the new faith he founded. So, like a new wind, the word spreads across the world. And for the Baha'i pioneer, there comes a time to say goodbye and move on. Perhaps to the next village. Perhaps to pull up roots and move to a new continent.
Because Gordon keeps writing and saying to just bring a few clothes and household things and that's all. So the thing is to just try to find people who can use some of this stuff.
I'm sure there's lots of people who would love to have if you had nice things.
Hello, Pachi.
Hi, Tina.
Good morning, Amy. How are you?
You're
good. I'm fine.
Come to survey me.
The mess. My gosh. Are you going to take all of this with you?
Not a thousandth of it.
What can I do?
I bear witness to thy unity and thy oneness, and that thou art God, and that there is none other God beside thee. Thou hast verily revealed thy cause, fulfilled thy covenant, and opened wide the door of thy grace to all that dwell in heaven and on earth. Blessing and peace, salutation and glory rest upon thy loved ones, whom the changes and chances of the world have not deterred from turning unto thee, and who have given their all in the hope of obtaining that which is with thee. Thou art, in truth, the ever-forgiving, the all-bountiful, Baha'u'llah.
We are all the fruits of one tree. We are all the waves of one sea. The day has come when all men must live as one. Ye are all the flowers of one garden, and the waves of one sea, and the leaves of one tree.